done in advance of today is ask people to pose questions to put to Maxine, and I'm sure she will answer them or not, as she wishes, and give us whatever responses she would like to do. If we don't get through all of these questions and you've posed a question that doesn't get asked, don't worry, because Sharon, who's working with Maxine, is going to ensure that later on there will be some filming taking place for any questions that are missed, which you'll then be able to watch at a later point. So please don't be disappointed if your question isn't answered. So, welcome, Maxine. Thank you very much. The first question is from Fenella Whiteside, and it's a broad one. So, compared to the craft in the early years, the 60s and 70s, what do you think of the craft today?
I think it's got too sophisticated. I think they do too much empty ritual. And too political. I mean, when I look at back over the in the 60s when we worked on Old the Edge, I mean, we were tough. We had to be. We'd be working out in the snow. I don't see many photographs of witches working out in the snow nowadays. And they're all into the big, heavy, you know, boots and white robes over the clothes. I'm not in love with the craft today. I'm in love with the craft and the simplicity of it and the power of it. And the beauty of it is I think that too much has been added. I think the amount of people in the craft is still the same percentage. People seem to think that the number's gone up. The population has gone up, so the percentage, I think, is just the same. I think there are a lot of people that think they're working the craft, but they're not. Does that answer your question?
Thank you. So the next question is anonymous. It's actually not a controversial question. It's an interesting one. Do you or have you worked with the familiar? Now, the person is asking this question because of some documents which exist in the museum on how to create a familiar by Alex.
Yes, he was always creating them. Which ones? He once worked with me to create a familiar that looked like Puss in Boots. It just amused me. Thought forms. Yes, but actual familiar, no.
To create it.
No, I mean, it's not difficult, but you can go a bit insane when you create a familiar. You know, that familiar is there to do your bidding for you, and you've created it, and your mind can become obsessed by it. So you have to be really careful what you're creating. My Puss in Boots was great fun, but you know, life took over, and I got interested in something else, so they just dissipate and disappear. Alex was really into creating, really bringing spirit or spirits into his work. I'm not.
Okay, next question is from Judith, one of the managers at the museum. Do you remember, Maxine, your first encounter with the museum? Did you know Cecil Williamson?
No, I didn't. I didn't know. But Alex did. Alex loved the museum. My first encounter was just after the flood. And it was shocking because the feeling regarding the museum, regardless of what you think of it, it is almost the heart of witchcraft and magic in these islands. So there's a great fondness, there's a great love of the museum. Alex adored it and just regretted that he couldn't get here more.
And how do you think Alex would feel about so many of his objects and documents being in the museum now?
Oh, he'd revel in it. Probably be able to knock those photographs up there. Yeah, he would really like it. He actually said it would happen. I remember working with some people when we first moved to London. And they were working in the circuit. It was a strange place. It was a basement flat that had been the servants' quarters. And we had a coke boiler outside. And wherever there was coke, there were cockroaches. Mm-hmm. And these invaded the flat, the horrible things. But anyway, we got men in to deal with it. And there was one cockroach left. And every time there was a circle, when it came to cakes and wine, it would come and it would just sits on the edge of the circle, and Alex would feed it digestive biscuits.
I've about Alex about the documents in the museum.
And once at Cakes and Wine, an argument developed between a couple of the men. And Alex said, we'll have no fisticuffs here, because in years to come, you will be writing about this. Mm-hmm. And he was right. He knew that this would happen. I didn't think it would. To me, I love the fact that the work I do and the work you do is personal to what you do. Your circle is what is most important. My circle is what is most important, not what other people's are.
The next one is from Roger, who lives in a haunted house, and he would like to know, I'm sure you've seen many ghosts, if you have, could you describe one of your experiences?
Well, no, I haven't seen that many ghosts, but I was quite fascinated with it. And I read a book by a Frenchman about water having memory, and that walls have memory of the things that are happening. So I can walk into a place and I can sense it. But my first ghost was about 17 years ago when I moved to Wales. And she's still there now. And she hovers on the staircase. It's a staircase that was built about 20 years ago. But this is an old Welsh lady. And she gets really mad when I don't go back to visit. And she upsets things. But when she's really pleased to see me when I leave her only a little time, there's this fabulous feeling of welcome. And you'll see the shadow. And I don't really tell people about this, but they all see. And I think the other place was when we lived in Salmerston. You would hear footsteps, like a lot of footsteps, like an army marching. And of course it's an old place for the Roman soldiers. And you would hear it, or I would hear it, rather than see it. And I think ghosts, we all have a different, the way we see things. Each one of us is individual. We see different colours. My red is not your red. And that the same with these beings that choose to be here. Mind you, I'm quite ruthless about punishing them and getting on with it. You know, don't be earthbound. And I think it's one of the witches' jobs for the general public, if you like, to come and get rid of residents' ghosts, but some people like to have them. You know, they're quite handy for a business.
They are, I know. Okay, the next question is from Julian. How was music used in ritual practice? What were the songs? Were they pre-recorded or drumming, etc.?
Drumming, to me, is a real act of magic, and it is the heartbeat. So we don't use it because it's incredibly dangerous, you know, when it's done with the consciousness of the magical act. Cotton musicians, I like very much, they become quite powerful within the circle because they judge the amount of energy that's around, whether it needs an upbeat or whether it needs to calm down. It's, you know, you can go into a circle and the energy can build too quickly. For instance, I was at the altar, and it was some grand ceremony or grand ritual, and I was dressed up to the nines, and I could feel this energy. It was like crackling electricity, and many years ago, so you won't all know what I'm talking about, but I had to break this energy, or otherwise it would just disperse and the circle would have been rubbish. And I just said, do you know, there are times working at this altar in my finery that I feel just like Fanny Craddock. And of course, the laughter broke the energy, but it enabled it to build up again. How did I get on to that? I told you I can ramble.
Drumming.
Oh yes, drumming.
And music.
Yes, and music. So the cotton musician has to be intuitive, but he's an artist anyway, so he is. If we don't have a cotton musician, we'll... My favourite is Carmina for ritual work, and I like Ravel Bolero. And I think in the 60s, we used to not work in the circle, but to raise par, we'd use Sandy Shaw. You know, it was a nice, it had that ability to put you in the right space, or the key notes of it. music, I think, is incredibly important. I've had, you know, witches visit and they go away and they say, you use music. And witches never used to do. They'd sing over cakes and wine, but music to accompany ritual, it enhances it, it develops ritual voice. It gives you a good feeling. And working magic or witchcraft, it's all about where you're at that moment. All the ritual that you do in preparation for that split second of working the magic, the music can actually take you to that split second and bring you out of it.
Another one from Julian. So what, in your view, Maxine, was the relationship between Wicca and the emerging hippie counterculture and psychedelic movements of the 1960s and 70s?
I mean, Wicca, I've got a bee in my bonnet about this Wicca business.
Tell us.
Yeah. Wicca, the word Wicca is a rare word in the Book of Shadows. And in the 60s, we thought of it as being almost a secret name for our working, and sacred name. So we could use it if we were having a cup of tea somewhere and it's a group of witches. He didn't want to draw attention because it drew sometimes undue violence. So you would use the Wicca then. But now, the respectable use the word Wicca because I suspect they're a bit ashamed of saying that they're witches. And I have to ask the question, are they respectable Wiccans or powerful witches or magical witches? And I think nowadays there's a very big distinction between the crap that, you know, pagans have taken the word Wicca and I think that's a sad thing. I think it was not coincidental, but I think the time was right. So all of the psychedelic stuff that came in and the hippie movement, I missed out on it, and most of the time I was in a circle. So I feel a bit aggrieved about that. But I think that, for instance, if Alex hadn't have done it, it was a time where somebody would have done it. So it was just the time. It was a time of transition. Where people's minds were opened and they were no longer prepared to be ruled. And I think we're going through another transition throughout the realms of magic and witchcraft now. I think there's a really big change happening that is part of the work that we're embracing at the moment, so that in a way these silly little fights that witches have, or massive witch wars, we can smile at them and say, well, they've gone. There's no need to battle anymore.
Okay, how much ritual in your past experience was done for a script? How much is memorised and how much is made up on the spot?
We don't insist on learning it all by heart. Mainly because it can detract from the energy that those words are to provoke the energy. But when it comes to that few moments, when you just feel that magic, the energy beginning to move within yourself and within the circle, and those ritual words come into being that boost it and make that power go and that work go into the magic. Yes, you learn over the years which words to use, and it is ad lib, and it adds to the power, but that's why we're in a circle. We're in there to worship the god and goddess, and out of the worship comes the magic. You can say we don't work from the script, but we'll work from the Book of Shadows. In fact, when the priestess comes into our circle, she's usually the last one in, and she's carrying the book. And the witches will stand out of respect for the common book. Not necessarily the priestess, but for the book. The book has the knowledge in it, has the basics of it, and it's from those basics we work. And we develop our common book that has a lot more in it than the basic Book of Shadows.
Thank you for all your questions. How do you see the relationship between permissive society and the changes in sexual mores of the swinging 60s? This is a reference really to the kind of the witchcraft photo shoots from that time period that we saw a lot in the papers. We've not got them on the screen here, but we know which kind of pictures we mean.
There was a film, we did a film, well, Alex did a film called Secret Rites. And a couple of things happened there. They hired a girl and a boy, and I didn't know this, but they were porn stars. And it was full of events from the beginning. For instance, Alex was going around invoking the Lords of the Watchtowers, and he got to the east. And he said, invoke the Lords of Air. Well, this man who was representing the Lord of Air passed wind rather loudly. And the microphones above, they were all around the circle, and of course, it reverberated. Oh, about the sex in it. Oh, yes, in the next, you see, I wasn't in it. I was pregnant at the time, but I was there. And I was so hungry, and I'd gone, and this tea lady, she got this jam tart and a cup of tea, and it was really nice. And I got the jam tart and a cup of tea, and I'm walking very quietly because they were filming. And I looked, and there was a sight I'd never seen. It was a great rite, but fake. And I couldn't eat the jam tart because to me it was, it shouldn't have been done. You know, the great rite to the witch is sacred, it's an offering. It's also a point of power. And we as the priesthood, you know, they seem to think there's this wonderful theory that witches are out there frolicking midsummer nights. Well, I've had not. Frolic or two, but nothing too much. But May Day, it's the witch, the priest, who watches everybody go off to do the frolicking, and the priest feels the power. It's no good going to have a good old frolic without using the energy. And people, the sexual revolution, great, great. But it was no greater a revolution than the Victorian ladies were having behind closed doors anyway. So, I don't think there was much of a thing about all this sex and orgies. I think the orgies were sacred and you enjoy them. And do remember, all cats are the same colour in the dark.
Okay. As you probably know, Maxine's written several books. You've written two books.
No, the first one was written by Wally Clapham, who it was ghostwritten.
Oh, I apologise. Maxine hasn't written any books. Is there a chance of a new book in the future? Because the last one that came out was Firechild, which is a little while ago now.
It was, yes. I'd had a dry run on Firechild. I thought, I have to write a book. Everybody says she should. Well, I wrote absolute rubbish for a whole year. And then I left it and put it to one side. And then in Wales, Mark Morgan said, don't you think it's about time you should write it? Anyway, it was amazing just how easy it was to do it, just flowed. And when that full stop, that last full stop was done, oh, it was a real relief. I missed the discipline of writing. And yes, I think there is another book, and I think it's going to be very different to Firechild.
Now, Geraldine Beskin asks, do you believe in reincarnation? And if you do, do you have any awareness of previous lives or existences?
We used to do regression because we all thought we were, you know, some great priestess from Egypt. All of us. We were all something great. And this regression went on for months and months and months. And when my results sort of came through, the realizations, I was a fisherman's wife off the coast of Wales, which explained why I hated fish on Friday. So, do I believe in it? Yes, but then I think, maybe not. And my job as an occultist is to prove things, is to study things, is to realize things. Well, my realizations of yesterday, I can disprove today. And so that chap that when he died and he said, I'm perplexed, it doesn't take dying to perplex me. So yes and no, some days I feel like an atheist and then I'll go into a circle and invoke the God and I can feel that power, that energy. Now is it an energy or is it just a reflection of the gods and goddesses' energy? I don't think we'd cope if there is such a thing as a God. I don't think we'd cope with the full power. So I tend to go with Mother Earth. I tend to go with natural cycles. I tend to go with the weather and create atmosphere that is conducive to making me feel really good and anybody else that's in the circle. Very selfish, but then I'm a witch.
So. Okay, this is also from Geraldine, a little different question. If fate had dealt you a different hand, what would you have liked to be? Are you a secret opera singer, a mad keen embroiderer, or very interestingly, she's written, or good at fishing, so I think she was thinking
I wanted to be a lady window cleaner, but I only wanted to do bungalows. So, I don't know. I've no idea. No, I can't sing, so the opera's out. I used to be able to dance. That was fun then, and I can't do it now. No idea. Oh, and I also went through a phase of, you know when you take your polo neck jumper off, and it's there, and the sleeves come down? As a young person, I look quite good as a nun.
Okay. This question is, what is the most impressive result from magic that you have ever witnessed?
They're all impressive. I'm always shocked. Always. And I suppose that's what keeps me going and getting on. But I remember we did a ritual, the Notting Hill Gate Rapist. It was a big nuisance. And one of our witches lived upstairs. And the rapist apparently had gone into her bedroom and looked at her. And she was really annoyed. He didn't bother. He just went through the window and left. That's beside the point. The police, who we have quite a good relationship with, wanted to know, you know, the sense of them with us. Well, we decided we'd go a step further, and we did a black dog of defence ritual, which was really great, really powerful. And he was caught 3 days later. So, well, was that the magic, or was it actually it was an inevitability? And maybe, you know, Ida had done the work and said, well, I'll have you because you didn't raise me. Mm-hmm. She would have rather liked it. She was the common whore. What was the
most impressive result from that?
Every single one's impressive. And it really is. I mean, we've done work, lots of healing work, which is great. Lots of work for money to pay the rent. Each one is impressive. And I don't doubt it for a moment, but I keep testing it. Healing work, that's good. But I don't think that kind of magic isn't the only thing that the witch does. The witch is... people in your community get to know that you're there and they want to come and talk to you without having to... nowadays become obligated to pay the counsellor. The witch is there, and as a priest and priestess, they have a responsibility to people in their community. And the community is worldwide. I'm not talking about the witchcraft community, I'm talking about the human race. And we don't do enough work to nurture our planet. We don't do enough clearing of rivers, we don't do enough blessing of rivers, and we should do. We have a responsibility because if you're a good witch, you're tuned in and you can bring that blessing through, and you're a healer. So, can't think of anything that's impressive at the moment. When I'm in bed tonight, I'll think, oh,
Okay, this question is from Joe, and where have all the sky clouds gone? He wonders why people are not practicing in the same way as they did in the 70s, for example, that you could practice the craft however you want, with basic tools which cost you little money, and now the craft has possibly become a kind of fashion statement.
In the 60s, I would always have blacking, and it would be a side plate for my pentacle. My athame and sword combined in one was a poker. You know, I didn't have the money, witches didn't. And today, if needs be, you want to do some quick work, I will use things that are around. But the witch actually is trained to use those weapons. But the training is to bring you to the point where you don't need the weapons. You know, which, you know, you think about the grand altars that are set and laid, and the water and the consecration thereof. But when you're on your own, you've got your spit, you've got your sweat. Robes, not robed. I believe in being not robed when the magic demands it. When you demand it, the kind of working that you're doing. Robes are very inconvenient, and they can go up in flames quite easily in some circles. We wear the robes because we want to change our consciousness. And not all bodies are that great, and they can really put you off during the night. So you have to be at the point, I think, of the magic within the soul. But this is my thing. You know, I know covenants that work sky cloud, and that's their way. We've always worked robed and naked. And in the 60s, everybody wanted to see a bit of bottom and a bit of bust. And they did. Didn't mean to say that they saw the magic.
Okay, this question is from Alison, and she wonders if you think there is a place for a fixed temple where all forms of pagans and Wiccans could meet.
I hope I'm not invited. You know, witchcraft is a cult of the heart. We used to learn at the heart. Now we've got so many books and everybody's competing to be the best teacher. No. It'd be war. And they'd all be outdoing one another with a bigger staff. And
Not a good idea.
I think it would be nice if, in some cult, we started it years ago. We had an open ritual on a Sunday. We've worked every day of the week, some form of magic, because we used to get so many people that wanted to be initiated. And when you discussed with them and asked why, one of the commonest things was they wanted to worship the goddess. They didn't need to be a witch to worship the goddess. They just didn't know how to go about it. And so we set it up. We did, my front room looked like a little chapel. But it wasn't a Christian chapel, it was a ritual to the goddess. And people came and flocked, and we had to stop doing it because we hadn't got the room and it was just gathering momentum. But then we did perform rituals that weren't empty. And there is a lot of empty ritual about today, and more concentration should go into ritual being effective, not just to make you feel that little bit special. It should be effective. It should be something that consciously makes you aspire to higher and greater things and the experience of higher and greater things. I'm rambling again, shot me up.
You're fine. How were you able to train and interact with so many people? Did you find it came naturally, or did the volume of people muddy your own experience of magical practice?
There were a lot of people came and they'd sit on the floor and Alex would be so exhausted he'd fall asleep and he'd still stay there, they wouldn't go. How did it affect me? It didn't. I had my children to look after and I had the shopping to do. So that that sort of thing. We started doing the soirees, and this is where people, because the phone was constantly going, you know, they were interested in initiation. We needed to do something with them, so they'd come to the soiree and they would ask questions, which is fine, it's time set apart. But it doesn't make you bigger, and it most certainly doesn't muddy your rituals. In fact, it intensifies them because your focus point is constantly directed towards the centre of the circle. You're talking to people about the work that you do. It does, it makes you focused, and it makes you see your mistakes. You know, there's always somebody that comes which will have a go. And when they're having a go, you think, okay, I've got to look at myself. Let me see if I can improve, get better. So I don't really think that's relevant. I mean, they all came because they read about it in the newspapers, because people wrote about it. You had Man with the Magic, you know, you had Alexander's on the television every week somewhere. So it got to be a household name. And so people came. You know, we had a soiree recently, and a gentleman called Eamon was there, and this, it was only small, I've got a very small flat in London, and it wasn't that packed, but three of the people in that room, one had flown from New York, and two had flown over from Finland. And Eamon was terribly impressed that people fly just to come to a soiree. But they are good, because they are hospitality. It is a way that the witch can express the hospitality and generosity and care. Because not everybody that comes to a soiree wants to be initiated. Some of them just want soothing, a little bit of wisdom or a little bit of common sense, good sense. So you're forever on duty, actually, as a witch and priestess. It doesn't matter, even if you're out doing the shopping and something occurs, you go to your inner work to deal with that occurrence.
This one's quite a broad question. Do you think witchcraft has a place in the modern Western world?
You try and get rid of it. You won't. It will always exist. You know, sometimes I get disheartened by the nonsense and the rubbish that's written or spoken about. And I think the craft is going to go in two directions. It's going to be the outer public, and it is going to be those that eventually they just go and they'll work in their heart, and their coven steps will be secret. It's happening, it's never stopped happening. Just because craft is seen to be, there's lots of speakers talking about it, and you get the Pagan Federation, and you get all these priestesses there, and we're all over the place. But the inner work is sacred. And that's what we focus on more importantly than, you know, spreading the word. I think the worst thing that you can do, in fact, I hate it when you've got to go and preach to the non-magical people. I'd much rather work with magical people. I don't want converts. I never seek them. In fact, they're a damn nuisance.
Now, this question is from Peter, and I'm not sure if you want Sharon to be involved in this. Can you tell us about the projects that you're currently working on, which promises to restore the Alex and Maxine Sanders legacy?
Oh, does it?
Apparently.
I think you'd better talk about it, Sharon. There are quite a few, aren't there? You're obviously in the room from this direction. This project that I'm working with the Museum of Witchcraft on is... It takes the Alexander's collection archives and puts it in timeline format. And it's really quite selfish of me, because that's just the way my brain thinks. Seeing history in timeline order just puts things in perspective. And while I started out thinking, put this in, there is no history that I can find of Alexandrian witchcraft or the history of Alexander's, the co-founders, and Maxine is still alive. And
it also happened that I happened to be working with Maxine and listening to the oral lore, some of which you've heard tonight or today, and how I viewed it as an opportunity to bring all of this together in an archive, a historical archive, that could be living and breathing. And the way, the reason I say that is because there are still people around who knew Alex, who knew Alex and Maxine, who know people who know people. And they're disappearing, they're dying out. Now is an opportunity to bring that together and to create something that future generations can come to use for research and just contribute to. It's a website that will have not just documents, but also podcasts, video clips, films, and everyone will be able to participate. They will be able to give their own anecdotes, oral lore, to this timeline. That's why I say living, breathing. It also, because Alex and Maxine were so much a part of the history of the time, you know, okay, Charles Manson, Sharon Tate, sorry, that's a bad example, but it was part of history at the time. So the timeline would incorporate some of those historical events that involved Alex and Maxine, and also other traditions, other magical orders. What was happening with the Theosophists, for example, or the Druids, and they were also connected with Alex and Maxine in many ways. And so this is what I'm putting together. I didn't have a prepared speech for that. I don't know if that gives you a pretty good idea, but open to questions as well on it.
Thank you very much. And we are just about time, so I want to thank Maxine, and I'm sure you'll all join me in that. She's given her time, and Sharon has also, to come down especially to visit us, and I'm sure we're all incredibly grateful. Thank you very much indeed.